Hi, I'm Susan Taylor with Scripps Health in San Diego, California. Roughly 30% of Americans are born with a hole in their heart muscle in between the right and the left side. In most cases, this hole spontaneously closes after birth and requires no treatment. But if the hole doesn't close, it can actually lead to a stroke. Now, you don't want a stroke. A stroke happens when the flow of blood to an area of the brain is blocked. This can result in loss of speech, movement, memory, and in the worst case, it can actually cause death. Joining us today is Dr. Matthew Price, an interventional cardiologist at Scripps Clinic. He is the co-director of the Scripps Cryptogenic Stroke Clinic on the campus of Scripps Memorial Hospital in La Jolla, California. Back in 2016, Dr. Price was the first doctor on the west coast of the U.S. to implant a device that closes that hole after the device was approved by the FDA. So you are a trailblazer, Dr. Price.
Thank you.
Good for
you.
So this hole is called, it's called a PFO. What does that stand for?
Right, thanks, Susan. So a PFO stands for patent foramen ovale. And like many things
That's
in medicine, like many things in medicine, it goes back to Latin. So when we are in utero in our mother's womb, there's actually a connection, a hole that's there between the right and left atrium that allows blood to come from the placenta into the system of the newborn. And that's called the foramen ovale, or the oval hole. After we're born, in most people, that hole closes. But in about 1 out of 4 people, it stays open. And the term for that is patent. So that is called a patent foramen ovale, or a PFO.
So how does it increase your chances of having a stroke?
Yeah, in most people, it doesn't cause a problem. But in a few, it causes trouble. And we believe that the PFO, this hole between the right and left side of the hearts, can act as a conduit for blood clots that can form in the leg, even very, very small blood clots that form, go up your legs into the right side of the heart, go across this hole to the left side of the heart, and then the blood gets ejected to the brain, which can cause a stroke.
So at what age can you get this stroke? I mean, does this happen in young people as well?
Well, we see it mostly in people between the ages of, say, 18 and 65, but it could happen in younger people and older as well. But as we'll talk about, we have really now strong scientific evidence that in people who are less than age 60 or 65 who have a stroke, that closing this PFO can be really helpful.
So what are the warning signs of a stroke?
Well, there can be a really a broad thing, number of things that can happen with a stroke, but we're looking at neurological symptoms. For example, inability to speak, garbled words, can't find the words and you can't mouth them, numbness or tingling of your arms and legs, inability to move. These are the key warning signs of a stroke.
So if 1 in 4 Americans, you know, 25-30% are born with this hole in the heart, is there a way to test for it early on?
Well, there are some basic tests we can do to detect a PFO. And what that involves is measuring things that cross from the right side of the heart to the left side of the heart. There are two broad ways we can do that. One is with an ultrasound of the heart called an echocardiogram. And what we do is we mix up salt water, normal saline, and make little bubbles. And we inject those bubbles into a vein in your arm. And we watch your heart on the ultrasound. And we see the bubbles come into the right side of the heart. And we can actually see them cross the hole into the left side of the heart. That should never happen. You should never get bubbles on the left side of the heart. They're usually filtered by the lungs. And the second major way to detect a PFO is something called Doppler, that transcranial Doppler, that we can do an ultrasound of your brain and actually see those bubbles go into your brain.
Interesting. So talk about a cryptogenic stroke. That's in younger people?
Right. So a cryptogenic stroke, if you think of the word cryptogenic, again, most things in medicine go back to Latin. Mm-hmm. Genic means coming from. Crypto is unknown, like cryptography or cryptic. Okay, so cryptogenic stroke is a grab bag term of people who have a cryptogenic stroke have strokes that we don't know why they happened. So we used to think that the PFO, or we do think that the PFO may be a big explanation of people who have strokes of unknown cause.
Interesting.
So when someone shows up with a stroke of unknown cause, and when we think of that, we generally think about people who are younger than age 65, because unfortunately, as we get older, there are a whole host of reasons we can have strokes, be it hypertension, buildup of the arteries in the buildup of atherosclerosis in the carotid arteries. But when you're younger, you generally don't have those risk factors. So we do a workup, a set of things, a set of tests to figure out whether we can detect a reason. And in about 30 to 50% of those patients who have a cryptogenic stroke, we uncover a PFO.
Interesting. Okay, so we want you to hold this thought for a minute. There's another underlying condition that causes the cryptogenic stroke, so we'll come back to that in just a couple of minutes. So let's talk about this PFO occluder.
Yeah.
What is this device and how does it work?
Well, just to step back, if you have a hole in your heart that we think blood clots travel through from one side of the heart to the other that causes a stroke, it makes sense that, well, why don't we close the hole and we'll prevent that from happening. So over the last decade, several devices have been developed, which we implant through a very small catheter through the vein in the groin. And there are currently two approved devices in the United States.
So this is not open heart surgery?
This is not open heart surgery. This is done in a procedure room. We do it with sterile technique, so like an operating room. I wear a hat and a mask and a gown.
Is the patient awake or are they put out?
Yeah, I like to say you get a few martinis, pharmaceutical grade martinis that we serve in the cath lab. And we do it guided by x-ray and a special ultrasound I actually put inside the heart through a small little, not even incision, a needle poke really in the vein in your groin called the femoral vein. The procedure takes maybe 45 minutes. We watch you in the hospital for several hours and then you go home the same day.
Oh, so that's great.
Most people afterwards, when we're done, ask me when I'm going to start the procedure. So that's just usually pretty
that's
easy.
That's nice.
Yeah.
All right, so talk about the clinical trials that paved the way for this device that you're going to show us.
Yeah, so there are two devices.
Okay.
I'll show you the devices now. Why don't
I
do that? So there's what's called the Amplatzer PFO occluder. And it's a very neat thing. It's made out of nitinol, which is amazing. It was actually developed by the Navy. It's nitinol, this it's actually a metal, but it almost acts like a fabric.
It looks like a mesh.
Yeah.
Like a mesh disc.
It's a nickel titanium alloy made or discovered by the Navy. And there are two discs. And inside these discs are is a polyester fabric. What's amazing about nitinol is that you can just collapse this into a little tube. And you can push it out of the tube and it pops back to its original conformation no matter what you do.
Huh.
So it's an amazing material for medical devices. So that's the PFO occluder, the Amplatzer PFO occluder, which has been proven to reduce the risk of recurrent stroke in patients who have a cryptogenic stroke that we think is from a PFO. And then,
so that basically closes the hole in the heart and then the tissue forms around that, correct?
Yeah, basically if you think about it, if you have a hole, let's say that between my two fingers is that hole, just sits like this.
That's it?
Yeah, and it collapses, and then it collapses into a teeny little catheter I can deliver. So, and then basically, it almost seals it up right away. Then in the days to weeks after the procedure, your body's own cells grow over these discs and hermetically seal it over time. And then the other device, which has been proven to be effective in clinical trials, is called the cardioform. It's made by a company called W.L. Gore. You may be familiar with that, the sound of that, like Gore-Tex. So this is actually made out of Gore-Tex, same company that makes your down jacket. And the medical department, of course. So this also has this nitinol metal, but it's almost like a fabric, these petals of nitinol. And inside of it, instead of polyester, you have this Gore-Tex fabric. So it kind of unfurls like a sail. And this is to represent your heart tissue here, and you have a disc on one side and a disc on the other side. And this is a very soft, pliable device.
So people who have strokes, they get blood thinners, right? And so the clinical, the clinical trial that paved the way for these, they compared people who had these devices put in versus blood thinners. How did the people who had these devices put in do?
Right, so that's the test, right? If you say, if you have someone who's had a stroke and has a PFO, we generally, it's really unclear what the best medical therapy is. It's either antiplatelet medicines like aspirin or blood thinners like warfarin or Coumadin, you may have heard of. Mm-hmm. So what we did in two big trials was flip a coin in patients who were generally on the younger side who had had a cryptogenic stroke. We either randomly by computer assigned them to the medicines, aspirin or Plavix you may have heard of, or warfarin, or they got one of these devices. And then we followed them over time to see how many patients had a recurrent stroke. And we found that both devices reduced the risk of a recurrent stroke by more than 50%.
Wow.
So that's a lot.
That's impressive. So,
and the thing is that every year you live, you continue to have that risk of having a stroke. So particularly in younger people who have a long life to live, that stroke reduction over time can be pretty significant. And the thing was that the trial showed that the procedures were safe. So the FDA approved these procedures, approved these devices, because it was a safe procedure and was quite effective in reducing recurrent stroke.
And so once these devices are in, if a person's been taking blood thinners to prevent a stroke, can they stop taking their blood thinners for good?
Right. So I recommend a baby aspirin indefinitely after either of these devices, just to prevent other types of causes of stroke. Mm-hmm. But you certainly do not need blood thinners like warfarin or these other things you may see ads for, mm-hmm, of strong blood thinners after a stroke.
And then once the device is implanted, does the patient have any physical restrictions? Can they you know, go skydiving and surfing?
Right. Well, as their physician, I don't recommend skydiving as a recreational activity. But some people do anyway. So really very few restrictions. For the first week after the procedure, I asked that they not lift anything terribly heavy, because we were just protecting the groin where I went through your vein. But after that, they can do whatever they want, be it skydiving, yoga, or playing Xbox, whatever they'd like to do.
Or maybe a little golf that was thrown
golf
in.
Golf too, yes.
Once the discs are implanted, is that it for the rest of your life, or do they have to come back and have the discs checked or maybe replaced?
So the discs never need to be replaced, because over time your skin grows over them, so they can become incorporated within the heart in a very organic, nice way. I do like to see my patients about a month after the procedure and 6 months and not a year, just to see how they're doing and confirm everything looks fine. But the chances of having a complication from this device in particular, where it needs to be removed or something like that, is almost unheard of.
That's spectacular.
Yeah.
So we talked about this a couple of minutes ago. Let's come back to this. What are the other underlying conditions that cause a cryptogenic stroke?
So when a patient presents to us with a stroke, we need to exclude several things. And some things are more common than others. A very classic risk for having a stroke is something called atrial fibrillation, which is an irregular heartbeat, which in and of itself is benign. It's not something that can kill you, atrial fibrillation. However, one of the complications of atrial fibrillation is getting a blood clot in a little pouch on the left side of the heart, which can cause a stroke. So for that particular situation, we generally recommend blood thinners to reduce the risk of forming a blood clot, and that reduces the risk of a stroke, like Coumadin, or you may have heard of things like Xarelto or Eliquis or Pradaxa or Cevesa, a whole host of drugs now. However, in certain patients who we think aren't great candidates for blood thinners, we may actually implant a plug inside that pouch. That's called the Watchman device, and there's other devices under clinical investigation at Scripps and other places. And that's in place of blood thinners.
What are the pros and cons of blood thinners?
Well, the pros are that we know they're effective in reducing the risk of a stroke if you have atrial fibrillation. The con is that you have to take a blood thinner, so it's a daily medicine, and there's a risk of bleeding. So it prevents blood clots from forming, which is great, but it's also bad if you have a propensity to have a bleeding problem. Yet another reason, if we go back to PFO, why it's, I don't think it's really a wonderful idea for a young person in their 30s or 40s to have to be on a drug like Coumadin for the rest of their lives to prevent another stroke from a PFO. So if we can put in a device, sort of a mechanical, non-medical way, to permanently prevent that risk, we get rid of the need to be on blood thinners, and then they definitely can go skiing and skydiving
after
that.
And they have
that.
A lot more freedom.
Yes.
And usually when you're on blood thinners, your skin becomes really thin, right? And you can bruise really easily, and you can cut your skin, and it bleeds.
Exactly. It can be a real nuisance.
Yeah.
There are other things we look at just to make sure that they're not present for people who have had a stroke, whether it's buildup of atherosclerosis in the carotid arteries, to look at your aorta. There are a host of things. We look at rare causes of stroke. So this is part of the thing we do at the Cryptogenic Stroke Center. Myself, Dr. Califat, Dr. John Rogers, we exclude these other things. So it's because a lot of times people will see go to a hospital with a stroke, and they may get a shrug of the shoulders and say, oh, we don't know why you had a stroke. Oh, that's odd, you're pretty young, we don't know why you had a stroke. It's really, it's our burden to go in there and make sure that every box has been checked and no stone unturned. And when we find something that we can treat, we should treat it.
So how many of these devices have you implanted in people, Dr. Price?
Yeah, I hazard to even guess. Hundreds and hundreds. It's hard for
you. You've lost track. There's so many.
I've lost track, yes.
Any final thoughts on this?
Well, I think that PFO closure is a really important option for patients because, as we talked about, being on strong blood thinners for the rest of your life is no fun. We've often, and these trials have shown that they're better than blood thinners as well. And there's also a mental peace that one can get to know that something that you have that's put you at risk for having a stroke can be treated definitively and never have to threaten you again.
I was going to say, and then you're done with it.
And then you're done.
Good.
Exactly.
Thank you, sir, very much. We appreciate
it.
Hey,
Susan, thanks for having me.
So Scripps is repeatedly ranked by U.S. News & World Report as among the best in the nation for heart care. If you would like more information on strokes and the PFO occluders to close that hole in the heart, please click on the link or go to scripps.org/videos. If you want more critical information about your health, please subscribe to our Scripps Health YouTube channel or follow us on social media at Scripps Health. I'm Susan Taylor. Thanks so much for joining us. It's our mission at Scripps to help you heal, enhance, even save your life.